Hey, y'all, welcome back to Leadership Unveiled. My name is Kayla Fahey Arndt. I'm your host. And today we're going to be talking about how leadership is a behavior and not a title. And I'm going to give you specific tips to empower people to be leaders without official titles. Welcome to another episode of Leadership Unveiled. Thanks for being here. Make sure you subscribe on YouTube or wherever you listen to podcasts. I'm your host, Kayla, aka KFA, and I'm here to help you stay organized while you live a full life and try to do it all like me. So let's get into today's episode of Leadership Unveiled. So just before we go any further, I wanted to say that this is a fantastic way to foster growth, collaboration, communication, innovation in people who really want to do more, who want to be leaders, who are excited and motivated, who are problem solvers. Maybe they don't know it yet. And I know this conversation is nuanced because now more than ever, people are really aware of being properly compensated for doing leadership functions. And I think that's really good. And I also wanted to say, I think there still is room for learning and growth and development to show that you are ready for the next level before you go next level. Something that I have seen in the workplace in recent years is that people come in very expecting to be compensated for leadership functions right out of the door, even though they might not have the title. And again, this is a nuanced conversation because I do believe in properly compensating, but I also think it's not this like, oh, you got to earn your keep situation. It's more of a, once you have a leadership title, there is a lot more accountability and responsibility that comes with it, that, and a lot of that is unseen. And so maybe the perception versus the reality of what having a title means is different out there. And so hopefully Leadership Unveiled can pull back the curtain on what that's like. Having a title and being a leader are different things to me. And one doesn't mean the other is better than the other or one is less than. It's just different. So let me just be a little bit more clear. Like, for example, my title is manager. So I could be like the worst manager, but I'm still in a leadership title, right? Like, but also if I want to do a good job, I'm accountable for so many more things than just exhibiting leadership behaviors if I had no title. Like at the end of the day, the buck stops with me in a lot of places. And so I don't think everybody is ready for that full accountability right off the bat. So I think that's why there's difference in pay grades is the level of accountability and where the buck stops. Your responsibility becomes greater with different titles. So in the end of the day, so anyways, I just wanted to put that out there because people are like, I've had a lot of conversations with people who tell me like, oh, my frontline doesn't want to do this stuff because they don't want to be compensated for it. And I think my answer to that is, well, you're not presenting it in the right way. You're not supporting people in that same way to feel like they're very important for doing this work because they are. You really need to show that extra level of support and empowerment because otherwise nobody's going to want to do anything. No one's going to just be like, hey, do this thing. Like, what's in it for me, right? Like this makes sense. So these tips that I'm going to share are going to help people who are you're trying to delegate to or help foster growth and like actually be like, okay, I'm on board. And that's the difference between, you know, just delegating and handing off work versus helping other people grow and develop. So I do truly believe that leadership is a behavior, that you can be a leader at any stage and title of your career. Lately, some people have been throwing out the words like quote unquote leadership team or quote unquote management, signing emails that way. And it, to me, it's always kind of landed like, oh, that feels icky. And I couldn't figure out why, right? Like inherently the management team shouldn't be bad, although they have a bad rap. Like inherently the leadership team shouldn't be a bad connotation. And finally, I read a comment on LinkedIn on a post about leadership, and it said these very words that leadership is a behavior. And I was like, oh, that's what doesn't sit well with me is the idea that if we call ourselves the quote unquote management team or leadership team, it actually indirectly surmises that everybody else is not able to be leaders, that they don't have the power to make decisions, or that we don't trust them to act as leaders. And that could not be further from the truth. Like, we need leaders at every in every job, in every area of our organizations. We need people that are going to be champions, that know the work the best, that are going to be the resource for their team members. Like, those shiny people, we need those people. Because just because you have a title doesn't mean you have all the answers. In fact, it probably means you don't. It probably means you don't. So I am uncomfortable with creating this unintentional separation that sort of handicaps everyone else from having leadership functions by saying, signed to the management team or signed to the leadership team. Like, yes, we are the leadership team, and you all can still be leaders. Okay, so I hope I haven't confused you, but let me help you kind of figure out how you can delegate better, how you can help cultivate and grow champions from anyone on the team, and to help them foster growth and collaboration, innovation, even without the title, even without the title. And eventually, these folks might move into roles with title, different titles, right? But here we go. So let me give you a high level of these buckets that I'm going to teach on today. Number one is fostering the leadership mindset. Number two is providing opportunities for growth. Number three is cultivating skills. Number four is building confidence. Number five is creating a collaborative culture. Number six is recognizing and rewarding initiative. And number seven is sharing leadership practices. So I'm going to dive into each one of these to help you cultivate more leaders on your team and empower them to be leaders. So number one, fostering a leadership mindset. There's three buckets in here: encouraging ownership, promoting problem solving, and acknowledging leadership qualities. So, encouraging ownership. You want to assign or delegate projects where team members can be fully responsible for the outcomes. Like, you don't care how they get there. You are just wanting to help them solve a problem and get to an outcome. Sometimes when we think about delegating, we think about delegating tasks. But that's actually not the right way to go about it. It's more about, hey, like, instead of do these things, it's, hey, how can we get to this specific place? So encouraging people to take on projects or tasks that will help them get to a certain outcome. Number two, promoting problem solving, asking your team members to propose solutions when they identify issues. The problem with having a quote unquote leadership team is people will just say, like, hey, I have a problem, and kind of leave it with this quote unquote leadership team. But you want to do what you want to do is say, okay, thank you for bringing this to awareness. What ideas do you have to solve the problem? And sometimes, in my experience, this makes people uncomfortable. People, especially people with the attitude that, like, no, leadership has to solve it, quote unquote, the lead capital leadership, right? But we have to recognize that as leaders, or with leaders with titles, it doesn't necessarily mean we're going to have the right answers. We probably won't, because we're not as close to the work. So getting people used to you saying, like, what do you think you would do? What would you do in this situation? What would be the best possible outcome for us? Like, what are some options that we have in front of us? Maybe even just asking them to give you options helps you to make a final decision, especially if that decision is barely weighted. But we also want to empower people to make decisions without leaders, so that the business and the functions of their work can keep going, even if we're not working. And the last one is acknowledging leadership qualities. So highlighting when someone exhibits leadership behaviors like taking initiative or collaborating, or, hey, that was a really great communication. Like, that email you sent was amazing. Giving positive feedback to reinforce those behaviors. Make note of when people are really exhibiting those leadership-like qualities. All right. Number two, providing opportunities for growth. Like I've said before in other podcasts, and I think probably already in this one, you want to delegate strategically. Let team members take the lead on presentations, meetings, or other initiatives. I have a episode on all of my favorite way to delegate, and it's called the test method, TEST. And it's a method that I created, and it helps me, it gives me a framework for who would be the right person to delegate this to. You don't want to just delegate to anybody, because when you're delegating, you want to try to set people up for success and not failure, right? So you want to give enough guidance, but you also want to select the right person for this. So go check out that episode, and I'll link it in the show notes. Offer mentorship roles. Pair them with new hires or less experienced colleagues to guide and support. So if you see somebody on your team who's just an absolute rock star, like promote the heck out of them. Be like, hey, like this person's a rock star. I want you to be training with this person. They are amazing. This is something that I have done to help build confidence in other people on the team, where I'm like, hey, so and so is a really good trainer. And I'll say that right in front of that person when I'm talking to the new hire. Like, hey, so and so is a really good trainer. You're gonna have the best day with them. You're gonna learn so much. They've been here for a long time. They are just amazing. I'll give people who are ready for leadership, more leadership behaviors and functions, the opportunity to lead and mentor other people. They will step up to the plate. Like it will bring out something that they haven't had to think about in themselves until they're actually doing the thing. So are there high performers right now who are underutilized who you might say, let's pair them up. Let's pair them up. The third thing in this bucket for opportunities to grow is create project leads. So you can rotate team members as leads or taking the lead on smaller projects to build confidence. So people who are interested in growth and development, or who you're like framing this up as like an awesome opportunity, say like, hey, why don't you take the lead? And along the way, this means that you do have to teach and help them with project management, next steps. It's not going to be quote unquote easy for you to lead them, right? But it should be enjoyable because you are helping them get to a specific outcome, right? So you're saying, okay, why don't you go for this? I think you're ready. I think you're ready. Just by saying, I think you're ready for this project, people are like, okay. They start to, it's a mindset shift. It's a frame shift. They're like, all right, I'm going to take accountability for this. When people get to own things, they feel ownership. They feel like, okay, I need to see this through. It's different than just working on a team and getting to someone else's goal. It's different when you're the one owning the goal. All right, third bucket is cultivate skills. There's three things in this bucket: sharing resources, running peer-led training, and focusing on soft skills. So, first thing, sharing resources. You can provide books, courses, workshops, podcasts on leadership and communication. You can share this podcast with them. So, people who maybe aren't like thinking in the leadership mindset yet, maybe aren't exposed to these resources automatically like you might be. And so you have to think back, like, oh, when did I start diving into this stuff? You realize, like, oh, there was a time maybe when I didn't have this information at my fingertips. So you just want to point them towards books, courses, workshops, podcasts, things like that that have worked for you. I think that's a great start. Your organization probably has a lot of free resources. I don't know why, but I feel like people tend to not take those as seriously because they're internal. To me, that's silly. Like, so maybe take the course yourself and make sure it's legit and then pump it up, or feel free to share an external resource because it feels more like, oh, okay, I'm like looking outside myself to get something that's bigger and better. Share those resources with people. And what I also find is just start talking about the resources that you're using to show like you're walking the walk, right? Like, oh yeah, I listened to this XYZ podcast. Like, okay, no, it's not just her saying like you should listen to a podcast. Like, she actually does too, right? Make it cool. Run peer-led training. So you can ask team members to teach each other about their area of expertise. So this is something I've done before where I'm like, oh, this person is really good at this area. You should definitely go to them to learn from it. And then connect those two people and say, like, hey, it's a matter of identifying someone's strengths. Like, hey, I see this person doing amazing in this specific area. They're basically the subject matter expert for this. Go to them for this and connect two people. That's going to help raise the confidence of that leader, that person who's honing in on that skill to say, like, yeah, I am really the expert on this, to start seeing themselves as more of a leader. And then third, focus on soft skills. Help team members improve in areas like conflict resolution, decision making, and influence. Oh man, these are harder. These are harder because number one, it takes emotional intelligence, it takes self-awareness, and it takes people to make intentional action towards wanting to improve these things. Because being better at influence isn't something that just like you do. It's something you have to like actively work on. Some people are naturally good at this stuff, and some people it takes longer, but they get it. And then other people, sometimes it feels like they don't get it. So this is something for you as a leader who's helping other people grow and develop. Pay attention to these soft skills and don't take them for granted. Somebody who can really hone in on like disperse conflict, man, that person is a gem. Like, take that person and say, like, hey, like, you have something special. Like, let's keep building on top of that. They make a great leader. All right. Number four, build confidence. Build confidence. There's three buckets here as well. Celebrating small wins, providing feedback, and showing trust. Celebrating small wins. You definitely want to recognize when contributions of these team members. People like to be recognized in different ways. And so this is something you can ask when people start. You can have them fill out a form. Just straight up ask them right now, like, how do you prefer to be recognized? People will often say like public recognition is really important. And a lot of people will say, I don't want public recognition, but let me tell you what I think about it. I think for a lot of detailed, specific things, if people don't want public recognition, that's fine. Send them something private. But I also think there's something about pumping up other leaders in front of their teams. And so I don't think there's anything wrong with saying like, hey, I just wanted to say thank you to this person on the team for doing an excellent job with that project. I know they like private recognition, but I just wanted you all to know that they are just kicking booty on that thing. I think that's important because it shows that you believe in them and it helps the team build confidence in that person as well. So I know people don't like public recognition, but I will just say, I think there's something to be said about like pulling back the curtain a bit and saying like, hey, I'm aware that they're working on this thing. And from my perspective, they are doing awesome. Like kudos from the team to this person. Providing feedback, offering constructive and positive feedback to encourage growth. I think as you're helping somebody hone in on a skill, you want to let them know what they could do better right away so they don't continue doing something that's maybe not quite right, but also pumping them up and saying, like, look what you did. You did amazing. This is so good. More of this specific behavior. And you can even say, like, hey, I know this thing didn't go exactly how you hoped, but here are the wins from that. And here's what you can do better next time. Make feedback for the future. You guys know that. This is what I've always said on the podcast. Feedback should be about the future because you can't change the past. But make sure you do have those conversations that help encourage growth. Say, like, you're in learning mode right now. Like, everything is learning. Something I also love is everything is data. Like these are just data points to help you pivot and do something different in the future if you need to. And then the third thing is showing trust, empowering people to make decisions and act independently. Something I love to tell people is like, you got this. You own this. I'm here for anything that you need if you want to bounce ideas off of me. But like, I fully trust you to execute this well. Like, I fully believe that you have the power to do this. And be serious about it. Like, no, I'm giving you my full trust and let people know, like, I won't check on you unless you need it, or I'll check in on you, but I trust you. Like, have that conversation. Do they want you to check in? Do they not? What would feel trusting? Would just giving lots of space feel trusting to them? Or are they like, hey, like, trust me to a point, but I would love your feedback at this point, right? Have that conversation, but let them know, like, they can make specific decisions. And they can do things without you as their leader, present. All right, the fifth bucket is creating a collaborative culture. And there are also three bullet points under this one. First is encourage open communication. Next, support cross-functional projects. And the next thing is use inclusive language. So, first, encouraging open communication. Allow team members' voices to voice opinions and to contribute ideas. So, a lot of this talks about using words like we instead of I. And I'm just going to mesh like the using inclusive language with this one, but making sure that team members know that they're collaborators or they're leaders in their area, calling them subject matter experts, letting them know, like, hey, we are open to your feedback. We would love to hear your ideas. We're going to choose our solution based on the ideas you all come up with. Hey, please let us know. Share your concerns with the team, making sure it feels safe for them to actually share. And then when you are going to make a change, be really obvious with why you made that change and say that it was an idea from others. So this is something I love to do is instead of saying like, hey, I had this great idea to change XYZ, I'll say we had an idea. And if I can, I'll give credit to whose idea it was and say like it was the idea that made the best sense, XYZ, share reasoning and say thank you. Thank you goes a huge long way. In terms of supporting cross-functional projects, letting people collaborate with other teams to expand their influence is huge. This is big. To me, like if you're allowing your team members to work with other groups outside of your team, that means that you are laying all your trust on the line and you are trying to instill confidence. There's a lot of criticism, whether constructive or positive, that I think you should give to ensure that team members know how they're being perceived outside of the team. Because when you essentially when you're talking outside of your team, you're building or breaking down the brand of your team with every interaction. And so if you want a brand of collaboration, innovation, the people are nice to work with, basically, like it's a good group to work with. You want somebody who's gonna be projecting that brand. You don't want somebody doing something that's counter to that brand, right? And so I think just letting them know, like, I trust you to work with other groups. I think your way of thinking about this is spot on. I think you're ready. Let me know if you need help removing barriers or have questions or making connections, but I fully trust you to execute on our behalf. And to really show what we can do as a team. And again, the way you talk, the inclusive language is so important for people to feel included. Number six is recognize and reward initiative. So there's three buckets here too, using shout outs, nominating people for recognition, and giving autonomy. So highlighting the contributions in meetings or company platforms with shout outs, right? We kind of already talked about that. Huddles are a great place to do it. Even just small group meetings like, hey, last week so and so had an idea. It was something we put in place and we've had some great outcomes from it. Just a small shout out is amazing. Nominating them for recognition. If you have internal rewards or commendations or any of that, submitting people's names for those rewards is huge. Even when someone gets nominated and doesn't win, often those names are shared. So it just shows that you are really looking for those sparkly gems. And taking the time to write up that recognition, that's huge. Giving autonomy, rewarding their leadership behaviors with more challenging opportunities. So, this is sort of where once you see that somebody can handle something, you give them more or different. It sort of builds on top, right? And so, like, hey, you did an awesome job with XYZ project. I think that you might be ready to handle this similar thing, but it's a little bit different. What do you think about it? Are you ready? Asking them, hey, like, I fully trust you to execute on this next time by yourself. Is that something you're comfortable with? Or, hey, I would love to give you this project for the future and support you in that. When should we check in? Letting people know they can own it. This is something that I think as a manager, it can be really hard to not want to micromanage specific things that you want to go well, because like I said, when you have the title, you are fully accountable and the buck stops with you. But if you give trust and autonomy, that goes a lot further and you don't have to worry about it. You don't have to hold on so tightly to things. So thinking about how you can give people a little bit more freedom in their work. And number seven, share leadership practices, model behaviors, discuss leadership topics, and create leadership philosophy. So, number one, model behaviors. You want to demonstrate empathy, accountability, strategic thinking, communication, like everything that you would want from other people who are behaving like leaders, you want to demonstrate it. This doesn't mean that you are going to be perfect. It doesn't. Nobody is. We are all human beings, right? But if you don't want someone doing something, like do your very best to not do that most of the time, right? Like we're going to err. But if you want to model, if you want someone to communicate more clearly, you want to model that and make it obvious what you're doing, saying, like, my intention is to communicate clearly with you all about the status of XYZ. Just straight up say what you are modeling. I love doing that. Just being like, hey, the purpose of this is to XYZ, because people aren't going to be able to read your mind. Like, why is she sending this? I'm intentionally communicating with you, modeling that behavior. Number two, discussing leadership topics. Hold sessions about what leadership looks like at all levels. If you're able to pull your team together or others on your team, this is really awesome. And this could be maybe stemming off of sharing of resources that you've done. Maybe you take a resource that you've shared, like a book or a podcast, and then you debrief on it and say, like, hey, how can this relate back to the work that we're doing and the work that we see and try to model within our organization? Easier said than done, right? Everybody's so full and their schedules are full. But here's the thing, if people want to grow and develop, you have to make space for this sort of development. And as a leader, it's important that you help them carve out that space. And then creating a leadership philosophy, sharing the values that reflect on a shared vision of leadership on that team. This is something I'm super excited to do at the end of this year, is to, before we start next year, is what are our team norms and what do we all value? And see, maybe we're gonna, I don't know how we're gonna do it yet, but maybe we'll all start out with what we value and we think is valued on the team, and then maybe pare it down and come up with things we can all agree on that are inclusive of all of our values. Because if we're not aligned in those, then maybe one, what one person finds really important is something that someone else does not value as much. And that's where the disconnect can be, right? Like if someone really values efficiency and someone really values communication and they both don't value the other two things, then it's like, oh, things are getting done really fast without communication, or there's more communication and nothing's getting done, right? So we need to make sure that we're all aligned in what our team values in terms of what's important for leadership. So empowering team members without titles doesn't just prepare them for future roles. It creates a culture of shared responsibility and proactive problem solving. It creates a culture where it's leaders aren't the ones with the answers. With the team comes up with the answers that best support them, that can best support the change and things that they need in the moment. And leaders are there to support through the change, remove barriers, and help with resource allocation. This is so important. This is such a mindset shift for many. And so remembering for me, what just opened my eyes was that statement is leadership is a behavior. It's like, oh, that opened up everything for me as to like why I was feeling the way I was feeling when we were kind of calling ourselves the leadership team, because everybody on a team can exhibit leadership behaviors at any time. And the more leaders you develop, the more high functioning your team can be, and the more that you can do, and the faster you can go, because there's trust. There's trust. All right. I hope these tips really help you. I feel like I had to go through each thing super fast to keep this episode short enough for our normal-ish time. But let me know. Email me at Kayla at kfaconsulting.org if there are any of these topics you want to deep dive in. And as always, remember, my free community is available in the chat. And we are going to be sharing some really fun holiday, festive, end of year things in there soon. I'll be previewing those shortly in the next episode. So go get in there. There's already some people starting to chatter in there. And I'm so excited to be able to support you and actually meet you beyond just listening to the podcast. Actually get in there and solve real problems. So again, that link's in the show notes or in the description of this. And until next time, everyone, take care, be a light, and I will see you in the next episode.